Donc, je reprends ma petite histoire. Et donc, comme je disais, donc, dans les années 80, émergent un peu des nouvelles thèmes de probabilité, peut-être un peu plus excitants pour les jeunes que nous étions. Et il y a eu un peu les théorèmes, tout ce qui était hydrodynamique autour de Kipnis, Métivier. Et puis, il y a eu les travaux autour des systèmes de particules en interaction et la propagation du chaos, qui ont été sans doute initiés par Alain Solzhenitsyn et Pierre-Louis Lyons. Et voilà. Et donc nous, on commence à un peu prouver des théorèmes de convergence, mais Denis va encore plus loin, puisque lui, à partir de ses théorèmes, il développe l'algorithmique et les vitesses de convergence de ces algorithmes, donc ce qui justifiait un petit peu nos objets et permettait d'avoir des approches algorithmiques, des solutions de DP non linéaires. Donc c'est pour ça que j'ai mis la couverture de ce livre à gauche. Je pense que c'était à l'initiative avec Touareau de ces cours au CHIME en 1995, ce qui ont permis un petit peu d'écrire l'état de l'art en la question. Hein. Et donc je te remercie pour ça, parce que ça a été vraiment une grande chance. Et, donc on n'a jamais fait de papier ensemble, mais on a beaucoup discuté et on a même fait des expériences de mémoire à l'époque, ce qu'on appelait des DEA, les masters, où les étudiants travaillaient de manière théorique avec moi et partaient après développer de manière algorithmique les résultats qu'ils avaient obtenus. Donc il y a Miguel Martinez qui doit être qui est peut-être dans la salle et qui est un témoin de ça. Donc voilà, donc pour tout ça, je te remercie, ça a été vraiment des chouettes années. Bon, il y a eu la thèse de Mireille aussi, et ces choses-là. Donc, c'est pour ça que je voulais insister sur ce cours du CHIME. Et puis la photo, je pense que c'est ici, il y a 10 ans. Ça doit être au moment de la conférence pour Étienne. Peut-être la dernière conférence où nous fûmes ensemble avant aujourd'hui. Donc, à partir de ces interprétations d'équations dérivées partielles non linéaires par les méthodes particulières stochastiques, il y a eu, enfin pour moi, mais aussi du point de vue de l'analyse, un petit glissement vers les équations pour décrire l'évolution des populations qui sont soumises à mutation-sélection. Hein, donc il y a eu, on le verra après, des gens comme Desvillettes, Pertam, Jabin qui sont intéressés à ces équations. Et puis moi, du point de vue probabiliste, j'ai commencé à développer aussi des choses et c'est pour ça que je vais vous parler de ça aujourd'hui. Donc, I will switch to English and I would like to present some modeling concerning the adaptation of the evolution for asexual populations, so essentially for bacteria. And so that's We in this framework, we assume so the individuals are characterized by genetic or phenotypic information, and that this information will influence their ability to reproduce or their survival or probability. And the evolution, so this is information is quantified by some real value or some vector value, and which is usually called a trait, and so that can be phenotypic or genetic, and so the evolution of the trait distribution in the population results from essentially three or four mechanisms. And the first one, which is very well known, is heredity. That means that usually the trait of the ancestor is inherited by the offsprings, except when mutation occurs. And when mutation occurs, that will create variability in the trait distribution. And you have also selection. That means that if at random individuals with a higher probability of survival, of a higher ability to reproduce, will invade the population over time, and that's genetic selection. But there is also in this model a selection which is an ecological selection, meaning that individuals are fighting, for example, to share resources, or if we are in a sexual context, to share males or females, and so on. Or areas to survive. And so that's why the model we developed since at least almost 20 years are called eco-evolutionary models, because you have this genetic and this ecological point of view. And so here we will consider asexual population, meaning that we don't have male and female, but instead, at least for bacteria, there is nevertheless some exchange of information during their life, and you have different ways to exchange information, and one of them, which is so this exchange of genetic information is called horizontal gene transfer, and we will focus on some genetic exchange by contact between cells, and which is the exchange of what is called plasmids. So plasmids are very small circular DNA sequences, which can be when the bacteria are in contact. So they can, one bacterium can send by some biological techniques. I have no photo picture here, but the bacterium can send the plasmid in another bacterium. And what is very interesting is that there are plasmids which are carrying the, for example, some gene of virulence, but also some antibiotic resistances. And so it's now well known that they play a main role in the antibiotic resistances, which is a main problem actually. And so we were interested to introduce this mechanism in our study. And I have to mention that the biologist with whom we are working from that is Myriam, Nichols, Myriam El-Karoui, Nichols' daughter, who is a biologist and has a lab, a laboratory in Edinburgh. And so she is a very well-known specialist for the study of bacteria. Okay, so as I said, we consider asexual population, and the biological assumption we will consider are as follows. So first, we will consider that we have large population. So imagine, for example, Escherichia coli. They divide in good environmental condition every 20 minutes. So very fast, during a night, from a very few number of individuals, you will have some cohorts of 10 to the 9 or 10 to the 10 individuals. So that's, and so we will consider the evolutionary point of view. And so we will assume that we have either rare or small mutations. We will see later how it is translated in mass. And we will consider some long, but in which sense, evolutionary timescale. So all these assumptions correspond to different parameters we can put in the system, and that's why it's a multiscale question. And a multiscale question which has been considered with different mathematical tools that I will summarize later. And the main goal for our process is to predict the long-term evolutionary dynamics, so the outcomes of this evolution, and to quantify the arrival, the successive invasion of advantageous mutants. Okay. So as I said, there are different mathematical tools have been used to study or to try to study in different context and biological frameworks, such sort of question. So the first eco-evolutionary models certainly were introduced by Menard Smith in 1974, but then, mathematically speaking, the first tools were game theory and dynamical systems. So there is a book by Hofbauer and Sigmund in 90, and then there are several people working with dynamical systems. And I like to mention the group of theoretical biologists around Hans Smith, who was at that time in Leiden, and they developed heuristics which were very exciting, and that essentially Nicolas developed and proved rigorously in his thesis. And that was the beginning of the story for us. And so there is a summary of this approach with a dynamical system from this evolutionary model in the book of Dieckmann of 2004. And then at the end, around 2010, there is a PDE approach, meaning that to the dynamical system, the studies, the dynamics of the population for a certain finite number of traits. And then with PDE's tool, one can describe the dynamics for an infinite number of traits. And so there is a famous paper by Jabin, Debilet, Raoul Michler. And so it's a pity Jabin cannot be here today, this week. And also by Pertam, Barn, Mira, Imi. So introducing PDEs, describing the dynamics of the trait distribution in the population, and by some concentration argument describing that the mutations are rare or small, they prove the convergence to some Hamilton-Jacobi equation using the famous Hopf-Cole transformation. And they interpret this concentration phenomenon in this context as the way to describe the appearance and fixation of advantageous mutant over time. So they have such sort of that's a simple case of simulation where here you have the time and here you have the trait distribution, but from the point of view of theoretical biologists, this evolution seems too fast. In the same at the same time, there were people essentially from a physicist, Volker Pakala in Princeton and Eva Kisdi in Norway. They began to introduce some individual process, so stochastic individual process, and that this paper where the origin of our work, first by with Nicolas Fournier and then with Nicolas Champagnat, to develop such sort of context. And so with Nicolas in his thesis, but with discussion, lot of discussion with our biologist colleague Régis Ferrière, he found some assumption of time scale separation helping to obtain from the probabilistic point of view a concentration phenomenon on advantageous mutants, which is here there is a simulation, different simulation, but with this assumption on time scale separation means that the evolution is very slow, and so for bacteria that's certainly too slow. And so first, it is now not clear how these models are related. And secondly, could we find new models for which the evolution velocity is seems more appropriate? So here the motivating question we had in mind that with the time scale separation, Nicolas introduced the mutation were very, very rare. So we would like to have assumption on mutations that they are rare but not so rare in a certain sense. And so second question we have is what new behavior does horizontal transfer will entail? And the main question I had in mind, because Pertam asked this question certainly 20 years ago, is how to derive directly the Hamilton-Jacobi in this framework from stochastic individual-based process. Okay, so I will introduce two models. There are both defined with a trait space, which is a discretized version of Zero One is an example. So there are toys model, and I will show you which the question we have in mind. And so the trade space is a discretized version of Zero One. And in both cases, we have a scaling parameter. So that's the main idea in our stochastic approach, that we have a unique scaling parameter, which we call K. Here, K will describe the amount of magnitude of the population size. For example, imagine that K is the size at time of the population at time zero, of the order of the size of the population at time zero. And of course, since we have individuals, they need resources to survive. And so you can also see K as the amount of resources, if this amount is fixed, or any quantity related to the population size, okay? And here a question which is not so easy in such sort of evolutionary context is that you can have mutants which are at the beginning when they arrive in the population, we have a single mutant which will develop its own subpopulation, and at the beginning it's a very small subpopulation. And so we are in a very large population, which is, we will see that it can be approximated by some deterministic model, for example. But we consider very small subpopulation, and we want to capture the emergence of this subpopulation. And then the question is how to track this subpopulation in large population approximation. And so we are not able to track a finite number of individuals, but the way we are to attack the problem is to track small subpopulations of size k to the beta, for some beta less than one, if k is the order of the population size, and in some time scale. And here's a good time scale, we will see why later, will be logarithm of k. So, of course, if assume that nk is the population size, and we consider it, as I said, at time t logarithm of k, we assume that it is of the order k to some beta k of t, meaning that beta of k of t, that's why I call the exponent in my dynamics, is logarithm of, we put one to be sure that it is well defined if the population goes to extinction, and it is this quantity over logarithm of k. And so our dynamics I will describe later, we are interested in the long time behavior of this exponent when k tends to infinity and t belongs to some finite time interval. Okay, so the first model corresponds to a joint work with Nicolas Champagnat and Viet Thi Tran, who is a professor in Marne-la-Vallée. And so in this model, you will see that the mutations are rare, but not so rare, and they are not small. They are of order one. The mutation step is of order one, and the mutation, the individual mutation probability is small. And in this first model, the discretization mass of the trait interval is fixed. And in the second model, which is a joint work with the same author as previously, but adding, we work with Sepide Miraimi, who is a specialist of Hamilton-Jacobi equation for population dynamics. And in this work, we will assume that the mutations are small but not rare. And in addition, we will assume that the discretization match will go to zero. So that's to make now I show you the first model. So in this model, we have, so it's a generalized birth and death process, but the individuals are marked by their trait. Okay, and the trait belongs to a discretized version of 0,1. That means that a trait has the form I delta. Delta is a mesh, it's fixed. And I belongs to a certain finite set. And so when you have an individual with trait X, so it can give birth, but here, if we think about bacteria, it's a binary division. So the individual can divide at a rate B of X, and for to fix ID here, B of X will be 1 minus X. Meaning that if X is small, the division rate is large, and if X is large, for example, imagine that X is related to the cell size. If the cell is big, it takes a lot of energy to survive and less energy to divide. That can be an explanation. And so when it divides with a probability 1 minus k to minus alpha between 0 and 1, we have a clonal reproduction, meaning that the two daughters inherit of the trait of the mother. But with probability k to minus alpha, then one of the daughters will mutate, and the mutant will have the mutant trait x plus delta. So the step mutation step is fixed, is the mesh of the discretization, so you jump. So it's a mutation, directed mutation to the right, and it's fixed, it's delta. Huh? And here the individual mutation probability tends to zero when k tends to infinity, but you see here that kpk, the total mutation rate over the population, is k to 1 minus alpha and tends to infinity. So in the previous timescale separation we developed a lot, this quantity went to zero when k tends to infinity. So that's why I say that the mutations are rare, but not so rare. And so the cell can die, and they die with this rate. If the bacterium has a trait X, it will die at trait D of X, which is a fixed D, which will be less than 1. Plus, here you have a death rate, which is due to the competition. So it's a very simple mean field, and even we call logistic interaction, which depend on the total size of the population over k. Meaning that the individuals are competing for resources, and then that create another death rate. And here we have a transfer, and I choose a transfer rate which corresponds to biological assumption, saying that here if X, you have two bacteria with trait X and Y, and so if Y is larger than X, then you will have a transfer from Y to X, meaning that after the transfer, you will have YY. So this modeling is related to the transfer of plasmid, which is not symmetric because to carry a plasmid is very heavy. And so for biological reasons, this transfer is called conjugation and is unilateral. And the transfer rate here is what is called density dependent rate. It's a fixed number tau over the total population size. That's the model we are interested in. And so we will consider it from the evolutionary point of view, meaning that we assume that at the beginning all the population has the same trait. So we have what is called a resident population with a trait X. And since k is the initial population size, so it's very well known if all you have if you have only one trait X, forget the mutation for the moment, you have a birth and death process with an initial population tending to, which is k tending to infinity, then we know that renormalized by k, the total population size converges in the score of space to the solution of this well-known equation called logistic equation, and which describe a large population approximation of the total population size over k. And that means that k and t approximate the population size. And so that, for example, can be found in the old paper by Tom Kurtz. And so if you have only one trait, there is a unique positive stable equilibrium for this equation, which can be easily computed, which is here 1 minus d minus x over c, which is the up to k, the in a long time asymptotics, the size of the population's at equilibrium. And now imagine that a mutant trait y appears. Then if we want to compute its growth rate at the beginning of its survival, then what it is? So you have the resident population, which is almost n bar of x times k. And so the growth rate of y is 1 minus y, which is the birth rate of y, minus d, minus the competition term, which will be c, which will be approximatively c n bar of x, plus tau over n bar of x, so it could be k n bar of x, but that's the individual transfer rate times the number of individual with which you can, an individual with trait y can transfer, and the transfer rate, you can transfer from one way and y to x or to x, from x to y depending on the respective signs of y and x, and that the transfer term is given by this quantity. And finally, if you replace n bar of x by its value, you obtain exactly this quantity. So remember, it's essentially the growth rate of the mutant y at the origin of the subpopulation with trait y, in the resident population with trait x. And so the sign of s of this term, which is usually in this eco-evolutionary context called the invasion fitness function of the individual y in the resident population of trait X. So its sign plays a main role, of course, because it will describe if the subpopulation with trait Y is supercritical or subcritical. And you see that there are two quantities here. You can have a trade-off between this quantity, which is due to demography, and this quantity, which is due to transfer. And so we made simulation of this, and that's T, we made simulation, and you can see what we observed, very surprising at the beginning, concerning this dynamics. So here you have all the characteristics of the dynamics and the value of the initial condition. So in the first picture, the two first ones here, you have here first the distribution of the trait. So the axis, the horizontal axis is always the time axis, and the vertical axis here is the trait axis. And the second picture corresponds to the population size. So here you have the time and the population size. And so what we can observe from here, for example, that or from here, is that the trait zero seems optimal, since the trait zero will increase b of x and d is fixed. Forget the competition. And so we could assume that by evolution, the population will drive the trait to go closer and closer to zero. And that essentially what happens for small tau, here for tau is equal to 0.3, sorry, you have such sort of behavior, almost an equilibrium with trait very close to zero. But for tau is equal to 0.6, we obtain this picture, and that was amazing at the beginning, and we didn't understand. And what does it mean? That means you have the transfer rate is strong, and that means that it will drive the population to larger and larger trait because the transfer will win in this trade-off between demography and transfer. But since the trait is larger and larger, the population size is decreasing. Remember, n bar of x is 1 minus x minus d over something. And since the population is decreasing, at some point, the influence of this population with large trait is smaller. And so if it remains a few number, we see them, I don't know if you see them, but if a few number of individuals is still alive at that time, since here the influence of large population, of population with large trait is small, then since here the individuals have an optimal trait, they will begin to develop a new strain, but after once they have developed the new strain, it is driven by transfer and so on. And we can imagine that explain this emergence and re-emergence of strains that's cyclic and almost periodic. Yeah. And so you see then in the third picture, so tau is 0.75 larger. And here you see that you have so many transfers. So here you have the same effect, but after these two strain emergences, you see that here the new trait which emerge is really large because it was no more individuals here. And then you go with larger traits, and since you have large traits, the population size is decreasing, and it go to extinction. And with tau is equal to 0.8, you see it's more radical, since here you have only one strain, and you go directly to extinction. That's called evolutionary suicide, and that's a well-known phenomenon. So that was what we wanted to understand. And as I said, the way to understand that is to study the behavior of the asymptotic behavior when k tends to infinity of this exponent process. So I show you two lemmas. Je ne sais pas du tout à quelle heure je finirai. Ah ouais. Which can be interesting by theirself. The first one, the two tools we used to obtain the main theorem, is that the first one is that if we consider linear birth and death process, ZKT, with initial condition essentially K to the beta, and with birth rate B and death rate D. And so we consider on this process, this exponent process, at the time scale logarithm of k. And we can prove that uniformly on time and in probability, this process converges to this quantity, which is not surprising, beta plus s times b minus d, supremum zero. The supremum zero means that we can have extinction depending, of course, of the sign of b minus d. And so, of course, that was not surprising because we have you all know that the expectation of the branching process at the time s logarithm of k is k to this beta plus s b minus d. It's not a proof, and the proof took 5 pages, I think, but nevertheless. So now we have mutation, and mutation plays as a immigration for the branching process. And so the second lemma corresponds to such sort of asymptotic property, but for the branching process as previously, plus an immigration at rate k to some c exponential to 80. And we consider it at the scale, remember, logarithm of k. And then if we add this immigration rate, we can prove that the exponent process, always with the same convergence, will converge to the same quantity, beta plus SB minus D, due to the demography, supremum C plus AS, due to the mutation, the immigration, supremum zero. And so when you have this lemma, you can observe very different behavior, as you can see here. Here it seems that at the beginning you don't have anybody in the population, but by mutation, by immigration, individuals arrive at the population and they follow the slope C plus 80. But if A is less than R, you can imagine that when the population emerges, then its exponent will asymptotically follow the slope due to the growth rate B minus D. R is B minus D. But you have other picture. Here you have a negative growth rate. So the population exponent is decreasing. And at some point, you have the effect of mutants. And here you have the slope of the mutation exponent. And then at that point, the mutation will drive the extinction of the population. And more complex, you have this picture where, as previously, the growth rate is negative, so the population is decreasing. It seems to attain zero, but imagine that you are in a compartment when you can obtain have immigration or mutation, and then by migration, you have new individual arriving after a certain time and driving, allowing the population to re-emerge, okay? And so that's why that playing with this lemma in the context, so I have no time to explain this example, but that's some dynamics of exponent you can observe. So in this case, and we can understand that for some example, you have periodic dynamic of the exponent, or here you have exponents which correspond to traits which appear, become residents, and go immediately to extinction. That's such sort of dynamics. And here you have a dynamics which seems really more chaotic. And so that the theorem that we can prove, which is based on the lemmas we have seen, is that when k tends to infinity, our exponent process will converge for any trait in this discretized trait space, will converge to some quantity deterministic function beta I of h, which will be continuous, piecewise affine. You can remember the form we have seen in the lemmas, and solution of a certain system of ODEs. And we know when we have changes of slope, that's when a new exponent reaches one and becomes resident, and we will change of resident trait. A new exponent can reach zero and the subpopulation go to extinction. That's some example. And we have seen also in the example that the slope of a resident of an exponent which was driven by demography can be driven by mutation. Okay? So that's essentially, so we have some answer to the first quantitative answer to explain the first reemergence by essentially by probabilistic tools. That's really heavy material to understand something. And so our second idea was to develop an alternative approach, which is now in progress, which consists in making delta tends to zero and to derive an Hamilton-Jacobi equation from this exponent processes. So if I have 2 minutes plus one, so I just give you the idea of the result we have. I was perturbed at the beginning. So we stay, so as I said, it's in progress and not so easy. So for the moment, we have a complete result if the system is without competition and without transfer. So you see that we have work in the future. And also, we assume that we have a birth rate B of X and a death rate D of X, which are such that for any X in the, so we have also periodic condition here, so we are in the torus. And for any X of the torus, we have a supercritical birth and death process for the subpopulation with trait X. So with all this assumption, so here we have, we assume, so we have essentially so an assumption which say that the order of the mutation step is 1 over logarithm of k. Here j is a Gaussian kernel, imagine that, so it's a kernel, imagine a Gaussian function, a Gaussian density. And here, delta k is now the mesh of the trait space, and it will tend to zero, but in such a way that hk logarithm of k is tends to zero. Okay, so it's hk, delta k is less than 1 over logarithm of k. And so that's the mutation rate from an individual with trait x to an individual with trait y. And we can prove that the individual mutation rate from an individual with trait y in this, under this assumption, is the function p of x, so is of order 1. So here, as I said, we have small mutation, but not rare. Okay, So I will just give you the theorem we obtain. So as previously, we consider the exponent process. And here we make assumption ensuring that the population never goes to extinction. So we are really in the easiest case you can find. And we also assume that initially the exponents have a certain Lipschitz property, because we will go to Hamilton-Jacobi equation and the good framework to study and also to obtain uniqueness in Hamilton-Jacobi equation is this Lipschitz framework. And since we want to make delta k tends to zero, we will make a linear interpolation of between beta I kt and beta I plus 1 kt for any x between I delta k and I plus 1 delta k. And so we define this exponent function beta tilde k of tx in that way. Okay. And what we have proved is that if at time zero, beta tilde k of zero converges to a deterministic function beta zero, then this exponent function value process, beta tilde k, will converge in probability in the scored space with a continuous valued function, continuous function valued, to the unique Lipschitz viscosity solution of this Hamilton-Jacobi equation. So here you recognize the growth rate for the subpopulation with straight x, and here you have an additional term with an Hamiltonian with it as this form exponential to the h times the derivative of beta, and this solution are understood as a viscosity in the sense of the viscosity solution. Okay. So the proof of such a theorem plays between probabilistic arguments, helping in particular to control the martingale parts of our processes, and using also almost sure, so adapting the proof of the analyst, we prove almost sure maximum principle on the increment of the variation parts of our semi-martingale, and also almost sure identification of the limit. Okay, thank you, and thank you, Doug.
Thank you, Sylvie. We have time for one or two questions, comments.
In the last question that you have shown, the last part, like the px integral of.
Il est parti. Il est parti. J'ai rien fait.
What is the role of, like, what is the integral? Can you just repeat what is the interpretation of the last px integral?
This term is a term due to the mutation effect. So P of X is the mutation probability for an individual with straight X. Here you have the kernel J, which drives the mutation distribution. And you have this term, which appears in the computation. Since here, remember, beta is the exponent of the process, the limiting exponent, and so if you write the computation, so in this term appears the subpopulation size, and when you play and using the Hopf-Cole transformation, and when you write things, you obtain this term in the limit. So that's the sort of this that's the Hamiltonian in this case, in fact, that you obtain like that, and you prove that it is viscosity solution exists for such sort of equation. That's the equation that was, from the PD point of view, introduced in the seminal paper by Barl, Miraimi, Pertam. Mm.
And it's easier to consider the exponent instead of like consider like the exponential of what you just considered. Like, isn't it easier to, instead of taking the log of what you consider?
Sorry?
What is the equation that must be, that must satisfy like the log of this of the, sorry, the exponent of beta?
Ah, but so you have at the beginning a PDE describing. So I just show you the equation for one thread. You have an ODE, the logistic equation. But if you have an infinite number of threads, you have a PDE, which is here. You have which is an integral differential equation, since you have the mutation kernel correspond to germ force in probability. And then if you concentrate the mutation due to this smallness of mutation step in the limit, using you prove that the population, the dynamics of the population size can be related to that. But I can explain you on a blackboard if you wish. It's a long, that could take long time here.
Thank you. See if you have more questions, we can discuss with Sylvie during the break or during the Zoom. Thank you again.